Dydh Da. Hello. Today we're going to look at a period of Kernowek or Cornish history where much evidence exists and plenty of archaeological investigations have occurred. This is the Neolithic. We can glean far more about Kernowek Neolithic populations, their lives and practices, compared to the Paleolithic and Mesolithic periods. It was an exciting period with all manner of new cultural and technological developments. Indeed, if the Mesolithic was the beginnings of a separate British southwestern cultural identity, the Neolithic sees that identity continue to evolve and flourish. But I digress. Let's first define what the Neolithic is, broadly speaking, and how things changed. The Neolithic, or the New Stone Age, is a period which generally starts upon the arrival of farming, which does have different regional dates globally. So the British Neolithic is understood as beginning around 4000 BCE and ending around 2000 BCE. But within that, there are three sub-periods: the Early, Middle, and Late Neolithic. The Early Neolithic occurs between about 4000 and 3400 BCE, and this sees the introduction of farming, population rise, and the potential construction of many sites in and beyond Kernow. The Mid-Neolithic occurs between about 3400 and 2400 BCE and sees further development and construction, although in Kernow potentially to a much lesser extent than before, with much more limited evidence from this period, and so some actually argue for a population decline occurring in Kernow. Finally, there's the Late Neolithic, occurring between about 2400 and 2000 BCE. This sees the beginning of a transition to Bronze Age cultural practices, constructions, and ideas, with over 3,000 round barrows and round cairns recorded in Kernow from the Late Neolithic to the Early Bronze Age. There is, however, an asterisk to all of this, which is the Bellbeaker period in Britain, a period that acts as a middle period overlapping and in between both the Neolithic and the Bronze Age, between about 2400 and 1700 BCE. This period exists in Kernow as well, and we'll actually discuss it in a smaller overview video of its own, given current debate suggests it has serious ramifications for all British and Irish cultures and ethnicities. Now, when discussing the Neolithic, let's also think about what that transition was actually like. In the Mesolithic, we had highly mobile hunter-fisher-gatherers roaming the environments of southwestern Britain, and becoming more and more adept at using their local landscapes, as well as the beginnings of their distinct cultural identity. Now, towards the end of the Mesolithic, landscape exploitation developed further, to humans drastically changing their landscape by burning forests to flush out game. Over that transitional period, communities will begin to adapt into a semi-sedentary lifestyle, which means they'll be beginning to build more permanent settlements and spiritual constructions using stone and timber. They start exploiting the landscape even further by clearing land for the growing of crops and the domestication of livestock. And in Britain, ceramics begin to appear, with pottery being created for all manner of communal, practical, and religious uses. But what was actually happening in Kernow during the early Neolithic? Well, there is an emergence of what are called funerary constructions, which is things that are built for funerals and death, such as chambered tombs and dolmens, or coits. We also see communities begin to come together and construct settlements and enclosures upon tors, tors being rocky outcrops rising out of hilltops. The reasons for tor enclosures are debated, and likely complex and varied for each site. Carnbrae is the most famous example from Kernow, with it having been a highly defensible location, surrounded by constructed stone ramparts and walls, whilst containing timber buildings within. It was visible from across the central Kernowek landscape, and some argue that it was a permanent settlement with farmland below, and that it served as a point of control over trade and the landscape for some communities. Others argue, however, that it wasn't permanently occupied, and instead occupied for certain periods of the year and for certain events, with its high rocky tor being seen as a highly liminal or spiritual space. We also have the emergence of a visible economy and the greenstone axe trade, with axe factories believed to exist in West Penwith, and the axes themselves being found across tors in Kernow, also suggesting that these tors became economic and communal focal points as well. And then finally, we have the emergence of ceramics, with pottery depositions being found across the duchy, at striking natural locations such as Roche Rock. Not only does the emergence of ceramics signify development of technology, but also the use indicates how valuable these objects were, and it gives an insight into these people's beliefs. Often, pottery was carefully deposited at liminal sites, perhaps as an offering to the land, ancestors, spirits, or gods. And now let's look at one highly important and quite obvious aspect of a Neolithic society: agriculture. There are several arguments as to how agriculture actually appeared in Kernow and the wider southwest of Britain. That it developed locally and largely independent from the continent. That through trade and contact with the continent, agricultural ideas and crops were brought across the Channel. Or that there was larger scale immigration to and colonisation of the British south coast, starting with the southern Kernow, from Neolithic French populations. Now, we do know that the preferred cereal grains, first emmer wheat and later barley, likely came from the continent, but that doesn't mean cultivation of native plants didn't occur, and thus the archaeologists arguing for an independent development of agriculture in the early Neolithic are not unwarranted. There are potential wild grasses and the like that may have been partially cultivated on their own. However, we do know that there was contact between the continent and Kernow during the Mesolithic, and maritime travel seemingly does increase in the Neolithic. So, it does seem unlikely, to my mind at least, that farming appeared entirely out of an isolated southwestern bubble. And going down this line of thinking, the question would then become, was the appearance due to trade of ideas and goods, immigration into Kernow, or perhaps a mixture of both? In terms of what a Neolithic diet looks like, we know from Hambledon Hill in Dorset that sloes, hazelnuts, crabapples, tubers, and mint were all consumed. And that would be but a small subsection of wider plants consumed both in Britain and specifically in Kernow. We also know that alehoof was one of the plants early Neolithic farmers cultivated. And then in terms of grains, emmer wheat was initially a very popular grain to cultivate, though it was later supplanted by barley. Thanks to isotope analysis of bones, we know diets were highly varied in Britain at the time. Some communities seem to exist much more on a high-protein and meat-based diet, whilst other communities lived off of fruits and cultivated grains far more. Most isotope analyses agree a fall in the popularity of maritime diets during the Neolithic occurred, but no Kernowian analysis has occurred due to the poor conditions for survivability of human remains. As such, it's hard to know whether this remains true for Kernow. But due to the highly coastal nature of the landscape and continued evidence for the consumption of shellfish, personally, I'm reluctant to rule out the possibility of a maritime diet playing a much stronger role in Kernow than overall in Britain. I would think it probable that these food sources would continue to be exploited. But again, there's little evidence either way for this to be the case, due to the poor conditions of the soil. Next, I want to briefly touch upon settlement during the Kernowian Neolithic to better paint the picture of how these people lived their lives. People today have this misconstrued idea that with the advent of farming during the Neolithic, immediately came sedentary populations, creating and occupying permanent settlements, which marked the end of a mobile and migratory hunter-gatherer lifestyle. This is not explicitly true. Whilst, yes, there are certain examples around the globe of big Neolithic settlements, such as Çatalhöyük in Turkey, they remain the exception, and not the rule. In fact, the idea of settlement in the Neolithic was likely a very different idea to what we have today, with it instead taking a semi-sedentary, semi-mobile form of life and settlement. Brooke argues that varying combinations of the activities which made up life were carried out at all kinds of locations, rather than one central place like a house today. So just be aware that when thinking about Neolithic peoples and the sites we discuss, they aren't necessarily settling down forever, but still travelling, making use of and exploiting a wider landscape and collection of sites. Now, the last broad theme I want to touch upon is conflict. I think perhaps so far, it can be easy to think of this period as some sort of peaceful utopia of development and growing communal societies. But there is indeed evidence for conflict across Britain during the Neolithic, and Kernow has evidence for this too. Most famously at Cambrai, the Tor enclosure I mentioned earlier. It was discovered to have around 750 leaf arrowheads at the site, and evidence of burned timber buildings attributed to the same event. Both of these are suggested as having been the cause for the end of the Neolithic phase of large-scale occupation, and a potential reason for minimal activity until the Iron Age reoccupation of the site. Some have suggested the reason for this attack is competing tribal influences over the Neolithic landscape, with Cornbray essentially taking the role of a medieval castle, used for controlling said landscape. Others have suggested tension between natives descended from the Mesolithic peoples competing with Neolithic immigrants from elsewhere. But one thing is for sure, the Neolithic was not entirely peaceful, both in Britain and in Kernow specifically. Now, remarkably, despite starting around 6,000 years ago, there are certain traditions that have actually survived from the earliest days of the Kernowian Neolithic, and we will discuss three of them in this video. Firstly, Cornish or Kernowian hedges. Now, these might not sound all that interesting, but they're actually stone and earth hedges, kind of similar to walls, and are amongst the oldest man-made structures on Earth still used for their original purpose. And whilst they were at their height between the Bronze Age and the Medieval period, the oldest of the hedges are estimated to date back to around 4000 BCE, with new ones still being built today. These hedges were and are used to mark field boundaries for livestock and crops, and it is frankly remarkable such a prehistoric practice has survived the trials of time and changing of culture without changing form. Next, there is a fascinating small piece of etymology and linguistic tradition that has survived from the late Mesolithic or early Neolithic period, and that is the Kernowian name for St. Michael's Mount in Penzance. The name, which I will likely butcher, is Carrick Lus and Cus. The name translates to the hoar, or grey, rock in the woods. And as you can see, the land is now an intertidal island with no woods around the area, and the rock rather prominent in the sea, connected to the mainland when the tide goes out. This isn't a mistranslation, but actually reveals a landscape now long gone, but one that was very present and likely quite significant both in the Mesolithic and the early Neolithic. The woods were in fact real, and the land is thought to have flooded during the very late Mesolithic or very early Neolithic, and sometimes the stumps of these very ancient trees reveal themselves after major storms. It is an incredible piece of linguistic preservation that speaks of a time when the landscape of Kernow was very different, and before any Kernowian or Celtic culture and identity in the modern sense even existed in Britain around 6,000 years ago. Finally, there's a little-known festive event called Crying the Neck. This is originally actually believed to have come from Eastern Europe, and slowly, over the course of the period, made its way to Britain, and then Kernow. So, although it's not a uniquely Kernowian holiday, what is unique is the fact that Kernow is the only remaining place, at least so far as I can tell, where the tradition has somehow survived the ages, albeit just barely. The modern practice is likely only a small ritualistic survival of the wider Neolithic events and sacrifice to a supposed grain spirit. practice occurs at harvest's end, when reapers cut the last handful of grain. They then raise their hands and shout, with feasting and merriment happening afterwards. And this tradition makes sense given how important farming, especially the completion of a harvest, would have been to Neolithic populations, and gives us insight into the spiritual side of such an important part of their lives. But once again, what is remarkable is that despite the odds, when the practice has seemingly gone extinct across Europe, it still remains in the Kernowek Peninsula, and was recorded multiple times in the 1800s as being alive and well, and there are seemingly still one or two places today where it still occurs.
Really, it goes back even to Egyptian times, where they felt that in the last bit of corn was the spirit of the corn. See, if you think about it, every generation follows another. The grain from this year's harvest will be planted for next year, and so on.
Sometimes we look at the Stone Age as this mystical, long-lost past with few connections to our modern world and no surviving traditions and ideas. And yet, this is one such tradition that helps bridge us to those prehistoric peoples. And that's that. It's a pretty general overview of the Neolithic in Kernow, and what was actually happening during these people's lives. I think it broadly paints a picture of more complex societies and ideas forming, and lifestyles changing dramatically, as well as new technologies and more permanent architecture emerging. Even on a wider scale, conflict, trade, and religion can be seen through some of the evidence we have discussed, whereby in the Mesolithic, these were completely shrouded in mystery. There are still huge questions left unsolved. For example, why did farming appear in Kernow, and what were the preferred crops? What was the conflict at Cambrai about, and what actually happened to the people that lived there? Did Kernow retain its maritime diets and culture from the Mesolithic, or did this largely get replaced by agriculture and hunting, as with elsewhere in Britain? I look forward to reading your thoughts and discussions in the comments below on these topics, and equally, I look forward to delving deeper into the Kernowek Neolithic when I finish these overview of era videos. I have some great topics planned to really shed light on this largely underappreciated and understudied period of Kernowek history. But anyway, Duganis Harmaras. Thanks, and goodbye.